Good evening, welcome. Please take your seats. We're about to get started. A few people are still looking for seats, so we might need a few more minutes. Hi. Good evening. Thank you for coming. I'm Sebastian Burka, the Director of Corporate Programs at the Chicago Council. I'm delighted to welcome Michael Auslin, Karl Friedhoff, Deborah Lehr, and Phil Levy to our platform tonight to share their views on whether this is the Asian century. Please note that Michael Auslin's book, new book, The End of the Asian Century, War, Stagnation, and the Risks to the World's Most Dynamic Region, is available for purchase and signing after the event in the back from our partners at the bookseller. Please also know that this event is on the record. Feel free to use social media. We are live streaming as well, but please remember to silence your phones. For nearly a century, the Council has provided an independent, nonpartisan platform for a variety of voices to promote deeper global understanding and deeper U.S. engagement in the world. We convene leading global voices, conduct independent research, and engage the public in the discourse on critical global issues. Views expressed by individuals we host are their own and do not represent institutional positions or views of the Council. Our spring season is well underway, and we have several exciting programs coming up. On January 31st, we are hosting Stephen Kinzer on interventionism in U.S. foreign policy. On February 7th, we have a panel discussion on the future of U.S.-Russia relations, featuring Ivo Daldo, our president at the Council, John Herbst of the Atlantic Council and former U.S. ambassador to Ukraine, and Sam Sharap of the International Institute for Strategic Studies. We have many other exciting programs coming up, so please check our website. And to return to this evening's topic, given the rise of populism and anti-globalization movements in the West, it would seem that Asia has an opportunity to become a policy-defining voice in the world. Yet Asia also has challenges. Among them, China's economy seems to be decelerating. There are territorial disputes in the region, and many Asian nations face environmental and demographic crises. So, is this the Asian century or not? Tonight, we look forward to a lively conversation on this topic. But before we begin, please allow me to introduce our speakers. Michael Auslin is a resident scholar and the director of Japan Studies at the American Enterprise Institute. Previously, he was an associate professor of history at Yale University. He has advised the U.S. government and private businesses on Asian and global security issues, and is a regular contributor to the Wall Street Journal, Forbes, and the National Review. Karl Friedhoff is a fellow in public opinion and foreign policy at the Council. He is also a Korea Foundation and Mansfield Foundation scholar. He previously worked at the Asan Institute for Policy Studies, and his writing has appeared in the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal, among others. Deborah Lehr is a senior fellow at the Paulson Institute and CEO of Baselina, a strategic consulting business with clients in Asia and the Middle East. Previously, she was senior advisor to the chairman and CEO of Merrill Lynch, senior managing director at the New York Stock Exchange, deputy assistant U.S. trade representative for China, and director of Asian affairs at the National Security Council. And our moderator tonight is our own Phil Levy, our senior fellow on the global economy. Previously, he was associate professor of business administration at the University of Virginia's Darden School of Business, a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute, a senior economist for trade for President Bush's Council of Economic Advisors, and a member of the policy planning staff for Secretary of State Rice. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming our speakers.
Well, thank you very much, Sebastian. We do have an excellent panel here, and it's hard to think of a sort of more interesting time to talk about what's going on as we're reformulating U.S. stance towards the world. What I thought we would do is give each of our speakers a bit of a chance, each of our panelists a chance to talk a little bit about the way they see the situation with Asia. We'll have some discussion, and then, as is our custom, we'll be turning to all of you for questions a little bit later on. But I wanted to start with Misha. Reads Michael, but somehow pronounced Misha. Never did quite understand it. No, Misha's been a friend for a long time, and has this new book, The End of the Asian Century. So, if you've listened to political discussions, in the last month or so, whatever our policy is supposed to be, the theme seems to be Asia's eating our lunch. That they are the sort of successful region, and they've taken advantage of us. They're surging ahead, we're falling behind. You don't necessarily see it that way.
I don't. But before I tell you why, first let me say thank you. It's good to see my old colleague Phil back. Mostly I'm grateful to all of you for coming out tonight, and to the council for doing this. It's great to be back home. I was born and raised here, so it's wonderful to see how the council's flourishing, and nice to know that folks outside of the Beltway are talking about these issues and taking them seriously, because I think that's a nice counterbalance to the presumption that we're the only ones who think about this. And in fact, the book was really written for an outside the Beltway group. It was in fact designed precisely, Phil, to counter the sort of the view that you put forward, which wasn't to say that it's not true that Asia has had extraordinary growth. I mean, that would be just sort of alternative facts, I guess, to put that out there. But that there was another side of the story to tell. I actually was going to write a book originally that completely dovetailed with what you said in a positive way, to say that our future needs to be an Asian one, that we had to change our Atlanticist DNA and embrace the Pacific within us, because for 40 years now, we've been told precisely this, that the future is Asia. The inexorable shift of power from east to west and the like. And if we wanted to play a role in that brave new world, then we would have to become more Asian ourselves. So I went out to Asia. I'd lived in Japan. I'd been dealing with Asia for a quarter century. But I went out to Asia, basically to get the evidence that would support my conclusions before I'd started. And what shocked me was that everyone I talked to from senior government officials down to, yes, the cab drivers in Jakarta and other places, was that they were talking about the fears that they had and the worries and the problems. And specifically, they were saying, you guys aren't paying attention to these things. And of course, I resisted it because I had the story that they were eating our lunch. And then after a while, began to figure out, as Paul Harvey used to say, that this was the rest of the story, and thought there was a good story to tell. The book is not predictive. The analysis I did was not designed to come up with a conclusion that we're going to have a war or there's going to be a revolution or anything like this. But instead, it's a diagnosis of the ills that I think we overlooked because we had one common narrative about Asia. The question was, for me at least, how do you do that? How do you encompass both the region and the problems? First, I felt, and I think these are things that Phil, you and I talked about back in Washington, is that our own approach to Asia was very limited. When we were at Yale, you do it as East Asia. There's an East Asia Studies Department, or South Asia. You come to government, do the same thing. There's an Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia and South Asia and the like. The only place that really sort of gets it right, I think, is Pacific Command. Even DOD itself, defense, goes a little too far. They go AFPAC. They go to Afghanistan and Pakistan. But if you look at what Asians increasingly think of as Asia, it's what Pacific Command covers. It's India in that great arc, that sweeping arc up to Japan, which is continental, it's archipelagic, it's peninsular. It encompasses, of course, more than half the population of the world when you put India in there, 40% of global output. This was the Asia that I wanted to talk about. The question was how to capture the idea of risk. And so very briefly, I'll just mention that what we came up with ultimately was a risk map of Asia. We all know what the map of Asia looks like, right? The countries look like and the seas. I wanted to capture a risk map if you were going and exploring the region. And luckily, we've got a lot of smart young folks at AEI who know how to visualize these things. So we came up with a little Lord of the Rings style fantasy map if you're walking through risk Asia. And the five regions are the five chapters. And I'll just mention them, and we can talk about them later as the discussion progresses. But first, it is the failure of economic reform throughout the region. Second, what I call the Goldilocks dilemma of demographics, either too many people or too few people, but never just the right amount of people. Third, unfinished political revolutions, which looks at the fragility of the political systems around the region. Fourth, why can't we get along? Why is there no Asian EU or Asian NATO or a significant Asian community? And then fifth, the one that DC really gets interested in, of course, the clouds of war. How close are we to conflict of some kind in Asia? And the book argues, again, not predictively, but argues that in all of these cases, the problems in Asia, the risks, have been growing. It doesn't mean they can't be solved, but that we have ignored them, again, as we have focused on the picture that Phil presented, the sort of common wisdom, and that Asia's future is threatened if it does not get a hold of its demographic future, that if it does not embrace economic reform. And of course, you're dealing with countries that are from totalitarian North Korea to freewheeling democracies in Taiwan and South Korea. So it is instead a call to pay attention to Asia before it's too late. And then a final chapter, which you have to put in these books, of policy prescriptions. What should we do? What should the Asians do? But what should we, as the largest external player in Asia's destiny, do? Some of them are things, and I'm sure we'll talk about it, that appear less likely to occur now, such as a very robust argument that we need TPP. There will be, you know, revisions as we go forward. Doesn't mean don't buy the book, by the way. Still buy the book, right. But there are elements that you know are tracking or tracking less with the news cycle. But a role for the U.S. in arguing to work with liberal states to promote a community of interest, and yes, to maintain a robust American military presence in the region, which has been a stabilizer, and the questioning of which has led to adventurism and belligerence on the parts of some states that threaten the stability of all. And so really, that's an encapsulated view of the book, and I'm very eager to hear my fellow panelists in their views and then to talk with you about it. Thank you.
There's a lot there that we're going to come back to. Great. Deborah, we're going to save you to bat cleanup on all this. Let's, Karl, you got your own perspectives on sort of Asia's ascent or prospects, and also especially on public opinion with regard to all of this.
All right, so as I was thinking about this, is something that we've been talking about a long time, this Asian century, that eventually Asia was going to overtake the West and become kind of the most important area for the U.S. to focus on, and maybe the most important politically and economically in the world. And I was thinking about mile markers, what we should be looking for if that is going to be the case. Misha's arguing that that is not the case, and as I started to think about it, I thought, well, if we're going to think about, you know, the Asian century, then the first thing that I would look for is China needs to become the most influential actor within its own region. And I would argue for several reasons that that is not the case, and that countries in the region also do not see China as the most influential. And that's something that public opinion is quite good at capturing. So I'm going to cover a bit of that. I'm also going to talk about another point in the book, the lack of political community, and then I'm going to touch on briefly, moving away from public opinion and more on kind of the research side, about the demographic risk and put a little bit of a finer point on that. You know, when you look at the region and the public opinion polls that are being done, one of which we have done recently with our partners in Asia, and we're going to be releasing a significant report next week combining all of these materials, that is, when we ask the countries around the region, that is, we have the United States, Canada, Australia, Japan, China, and South Korea involved in this survey. Basically, none of those countries see China as the most influential country. So the Americans and Australians certainly do not. There's been more recent work out of South Korea, where this was published, I think, just today, that they view the U.S. as the most influential country. And the Japanese, while that question wasn't specifically asked in our survey, I'm fairly certain, given the relationship between Japan, China, and the U.S., that Japan would also come down as citing China or the United States as being the most influential. One thing that has changed is that Americans over time are seeing the U.S. as less influential, and there's been a rise in the perception of China as being more influential. But what has happened is that in the early, I guess, from 2002 to 2010-ish, that gap was closing rapidly, but since then it has narrowed off. And so now the gap is relatively stable. And that's not only happening here, but that's also taking place in Asia. And I think there's a greater recognition, as Misha kind of alluded to, that among Asians themselves, they're more aware of the problems that are taking place in their region and in China specifically. So the expectation that China is going to overtake the U.S., I think, is starting to be somewhat tapering off. Of course, there are different components of influence. You know, you have the economic side, you have the military influence, political influence, and soft power. And of course, a lot of those things will tend to overlap. This is a question we asked in our survey, specifically on the economic and the military influence. So in terms of economics, interestingly, The US and Australia cited the Chinese as being more powerful in terms of economics. But when in Japan and China, they cited the United States as being more powerful economically. On the military side, the US, Japan, China, basically there's a pretty broad agreement that the US is more powerful, and the Chinese also see that. You know, and one of the examples I would use, it falls in a bit on the political side, but you know, if you talk to people who have worked in the White House during natural disasters, you know, if there's an earthquake or a tsunami, or in some cases both, if something happens and people need to get on the phone to call for help, they don't call China. You know, their first call is always to the United States because they know that the United States will be there to provide that help. And I think that is one instance where we're looking at influence. Now, of course, there is a huge caveat on this. It's already been touched on somewhat, that what is going to happen under the Trump administration. You know, I mentioned before that gap that we see between the United States and China. I think there's a real chance that will begin to narrow, and that could certainly happen. You know, we've already seen, I think, well, I would argue, a reduction in real influence in Asia with withdrawal from TPP. And I think there's going to be a decline in perceived influence as well. It's perceived influence is related to leader favorability. When you have an unfavorable leader, it impacts views of the country. We see that quite clearly. And we've started to see, you know, polls coming out of South Korea, polls coming out of Japan, where 67-70% think that the Trump administration is going to negatively affect bilateral relations. And I think that will eventually filter up into politics. The other point I want to touch on is this lack of political community. This is something that Misha draws out in the book. And if you've been following the news, you're quickly discovering that no one can really agree on anything. History is a constant issue that continues to come up, specifically in Northeast Asia, but of course Southeast Asia also has its historical grievances that come up, although in a more muted way. What we used to see is that there was a very distinct division between politics and business. You know, everyone was happy to let politics slide as long as everyone was making money, but over the past couple years, those lines have started to blur a bit. And more recently, we've seen China take economic retaliation for South Korea taking a security decision to place an anti-missile battery in South Korean territory. And I think that's a real concern, I think, for Asia, is that if that blurry line, or if that line starts to blur and then break down, security decisions are gonna overlap with economic decisions. And this lack of political community is really going to hurt the region. You know, when we look at public opinion, you know, the Japanese public opinion cites relations with South Korea as being bad and worsening. South Korea cites relations with Japan as being bad and worsening. China says about the same thing about Japan. And so, and especially in Northeast Asia, no one can quite get together. So this lack of political community really undercuts their influence as a whole. The last point I'll touch on is on demographics. This is something that's talked about in the book, and I want to try to put a little bit finer point on it. You know, when you look at Japan and South Korea, the fact that they have low birth rates and their populations are getting ready to start declining, at least in the next decade, and in some cases their economically active population is already in decline. Of course, the first thing people think is, well, they just need to open up their borders. Open up their borders, bring in immigration, and that will be one of the big solutions. The problem with that is that there is virtually no amount of immigration that is going to solve their problems. And in fact, the kind of immigration that is going to be required may make problems even worse in other areas. So right now, if you look at South Korea as an example, last year was the peak of their economically active population, from 15 to 64. So every year from now is going to decline. There are estimates out there, and if you pull up the numbers, essentially between from starting this year until 2060, and forgetting that the world exists after 2060, or hopefully will exist after 2060, that every year from now until then, South Korea is going to need 350,000 new immigrants every year. Currently, they add about 60,000 every year. So you would need an immediate six-fold increase. And by the time it's all said and done in 2060, approximately 35% of the South Korean population would be non-Korean. That's in a country where currently under 3% of the country is non-Korean. And so this idea that immigration is going to be an easy fix and is going to be kind of popular, it's going to create all kinds of social upheaval, social problems, and I just don't think it's a realistic solution. So those demographic risks are going to continue on, and I think that's going to be true for Japan and will eventually be true for China as well.
Thank you. And Carl says this as someone who spent a long time living in Korea as a non-Korean, yeah. So he knows wherever he speaks. Deborah, we talk about all of Asia, but for a number of reasons, China is focal in this, both the sort of the growth they've had, the size of the trading relationship, the sense of perhaps a strategic rivalry. Where do you see things going with China?
All right, well, thank you so much for having me here tonight. And I learned just before we came on that I was expected to be the optimistic one. So I'm a little nervous for all of you
the rule is
to try and find optimism in all of this. But I'd like to actually start with a quote that some of you may have missed today. And I think it's kind of an important one symbolically. But it's, "We remain convinced that economic openness serves everyone better at home and abroad. The world is a community of shared destiny. It's far preferable for countries to trade goods and services and bond through investment partnerships than to trade barbs and build barriers." So was written by Premier Li Keqiang today in an op-ed in Business Week, a publication that, of course, is not allowed to be published in China. So there's a certain irony that I find in that, and also as a former trade negotiator, that here we have the Chinese stepping up on trade to take a leadership role. So tonight, clearly, we're here to talk about the future of Asia. And Misha has written this excellent book looking at risk across these five different areas and has been very good at looking at what the opportunities are and what the challenges are. But I would argue that really what is going to determine the future role of Asia is going to be the dynamic that comes between the US and China relationship. And as with most of us, most of the countries in Asia are watching very carefully what the new Trump administration is going to be doing. The path forward is definitely not clear at the moment, but there are certain things that are certain through his statements, and that is that China is going to be in the spotlight. We can see it already, and what happens in the bilateral relationship is going to really determine the role that Asian countries are forced to play, whether it's as a cooperative agreement or if it is in the context of forcing them to take sides. And as we just have a few minutes, there are just three points that I'd like to highlight for all of you to think about as you look at the future of US-China relations. One is we have two presidents who are disruptors in chief. Both of them are looking to bring about not just change at home, but change abroad. For Xi Jinping, he's looking to change China in every possible way, economically, socially, militarily, and its foreign policy. We see a much more aggressive foreign policy under Xi Jinping, particularly as their economic interests go abroad, their foreign policy is following. We see them more active in the Middle East, in our backyard in Latin America, and they're building now military bases to start to follow those economic and foreign policy interests. And in the first full 4 days of President Trump, we've certainly seen a lot of change. We're building a wall, and we have outlines of what's going to be a whole new trade policy on the economic front. Pulled out of TPP, but launching a series of bilateral negotiations, which could potentially look, as we were discussing earlier, when they're concluded as TPP in a different format. But when it comes to China, expect to see very aggressive negotiations, and that will be based on using very strategic use of our trade remedies and bilateral negotiations, but also looking at increased restrictions on Chinese investment in particular coming into the United States. The second point is there is no loyalty to the global liberal order on either side. For the Chinese, while they have used that to their benefit, and certainly they've joined a lot of the institutions, the WTO, the World Bank, the United Nations that uphold these, they have not hesitated to build their own institutions or take other routes when they felt that these institutions weren't either including their own beliefs or were contrary to them, and they couldn't achieve anything through them. Certainly for the new, and they've got around through this through the creation, obviously, of the Asian Investment Bank and this One Belt, One Road strategy that they have. For the new administration coming in, certainly, President Trump does not come from a government policy background, and nor does most of his cabinet. And so when they look at the order, they've been very clear that what they are promoting is America First. And when America First may conflict with the existing order, chances are they're going to pick America First, and American interests will prevail. trade is where we see this most prominently and dramatically with the withdrawal from TPP, but there is also talk of actions that potentially would be contrary to what the tenure, what the restrictions are within the World Trade Organization. And so I would be watching that very carefully, because those kinds of actions have the potential of undermining these institutions that we've spent so long building up. And we're looking back to the future in many ways for our policies. With Xi Jinping, what he has been taking on in terms of reestablishing the central role of the Communist Party, he views that as the way to govern. They don't necessarily have the government tools and institutions for him to ensure that policy is actually implemented on a consistent basis at a local level. So they are making policy through these outside entities, so-called leading groups, that then ensure that the government bureaucracy is actually implementing it, and they even send out policy enforcement teams to check on local mayors and governors to ensure that they are implementing policy in the way that he wanted to. These are things very similar to what Chairman Mao did. And when we look at what President Trump's new trade policy is, it's no surprise, given maybe some of the people who are coming in, including the new U.S. Trade Representative who served in the Reagan administration, that much of what we're hearing is very similar to the kinds of trade policies that we saw under Reagan and Bush. We're talking again about steel. That was the big issue at the end of the Reagan administration and early Bush administration. We're talking about an emphasis on bilateral negotiations. That was the focus in those years as well. WTO came in under Clinton, although it was negotiated under Bush, but until that time there had been a significant focus. And we were looking at initiatives with countries like Japan that were outside of the rules of the WTO. They were just called something different to try and get around those rules. Voluntary agreements, for example. This is probably what we will start to see with China. And in an appeal to many of the Reagan-collared workers, obviously there's going to be creative use of our trade remedies. That in the past, typically, even though it's allowed under law, the government did not self-initiate anti-dumping cases. That is going to be revisited, and trade policy is going to be run, at least initially, from the Commerce Department, which is unheard of.
So, what do you mean, usually this is sort of a private company files the complaint.
A private company files the complaint. The government does not self-initiate them. But you don't tend to get them in your most strategic industries. In contrast, China picks our most strategic industries to go after when they do their anti-dumping cases. So where do we find common interests? As President Xi has said to us, if we're not building positive momentum, it's the negative momentum that takes over. And the traditional areas of cooperation between the United States and China, particularly in the last 16 years, have been trade, investment, and climate change. That is not going to be the case with this administration. And outside of North Korea, I think we're going to have to take a wait-and-see approach as to where those are going to be coming from. Ironically, it's the Chinese, though, who could most help President Trump in implementing much of his own agenda, and they've been actually quite clear on that privately. They create 15 million jobs a year. They can help him create jobs here. They have a lot of money to invest overseas, and they're experts at building infrastructure, including walls. So there is the potential of a lot of cooperation. But as you can see by Li Keqiang's op-ed, China has stepped in to fill the leadership role and leadership void that is coming out in trade and climate change. And Asian countries are now talking amongst themselves about building and negotiating alternatives to TPP. And so as we look ahead, the U.S. isn't in any of those discussions. We're on the sidelines. We are potentially leaving a lot of our own strategic interests on the table when it comes to Asia. And I would argue this is the time for the U.S. to be much more aggressive, not to be retreating, in what our strategic interests are and pursuing them, particularly as we look at, again, in the context of U.S.-China relations, China stepping up its own role, taking on the potential of being the leader in Asia and leaving the U.S. on the sidelines.
Thank you. So it's hard to be optimistic these days, but you did a fine job to stab at it. I want to pose a couple questions. We'll come to policy in a minute. I'll pose this to Misha, but it's actually for all of you. It's going to take advantage of Misha's background as a historian, which is, as we're thinking about the trajectory of Asia maybe in absolute terms or relative to the US, how much of this is determined by some of these longer run, almost timeless trends, things like demographics — it's not timeless, but demographics, Asian culture and the like — and how much is it the sort of policies that we're talking about that Xi Jinping is pursuing or that the new Trump administration is pursuing? How do you see that balance?
In terms of the problems that
we're in terms of where we think they're going, is this all sort of baked in and independent of policy, or do we have a lot of control over how this goes?
That's a good question. I don't think I've thought about it in those terms yet. As a historian, I think it's always a combination. Nothing's monocausal. Things are too complex. But I think a lot of the issues that we've all talked about, certainly that I focus on in the book, they've been caused by policy. Look at China's pollution problem, and you've all seen the pictures on Twitter in recent weeks. That's a policy choice of what not to do and what you are doing. I think the same thing in terms of, demographics is actually very interesting, right? And I certainly defer to Carl, but there are arguments. So Japan's replacement rate and its birth rate fell below what was replacement level back in the 1970s. There's been almost a half a century of knowing that you would get to this point where you are actively losing population. So on the one hand, they couldn't come up yet with any policies that would get people to have more children. But more interestingly is, why did people stop? And many would people argue it's because of policy choices that were made regarding the consumer economy, regarding standard of living and things like that. So I tend to think that most of this is related to policies. And certainly when you get to the security side, almost all of this is policy. You can hark back to, as China's doing in the South China Sea, these fictive traditional claims on territory that stretch as far afield as Japan and the Philippines. But it's really policy that drives it. It's policy to build and militarize islands that were just shoals, a few years ago. And we have certainly, on our own end, in a risk-averse way, stood back and watched these policies emerge and really done very little about it, in part because what we wanted to do, and particularly this is, I think, a posit to the China case that Deborah was talking about, we wanted to separate the economics from the security and the politics. What Trump has actually done is to self-consciously relink them. And he did that right away in terms of tweets and statements. Why should I uphold be bound by the One China policy if China's not going to play nice in X? And that is how that policy is being upended, because it relinks things that we self-consciously, as a policy choice, put on separate paths. Now they're going to come back together, and they're going to clash.
Did you guys want to take on the sort of relative balance that you see in this?
No, I would agree with Misha. I think it's all generally policy decisions that are driving this. It was policy decisions that unlocked the potential of China. It's a policy decision on the part of North Korea to stay as isolated as it is. And so, there is this longer arc of history where you have this fluctuation of states rising, states falling, but policy ultimately drives that.
Yeah, and I would agree. I mean, certainly if you going back and just looking at the trade example, we have not had a trade agreement with China in 15 years. Now, that is a long time when you look at the development of China's economy. China's WTO accession was the last major trade agreement. That was a conscious decision by administrations, I worked on China's WTO accession, but that was a conscious decision to negotiate major trade agreements like TPP at the risk that we were not doing smaller ones to try and move China in the right direction. As a result, I believe we've not seen significant market opening in China in the past 10 years. That leads to a lot of the conflict that we're hearing now from, obviously, the Trump administration with, why can they come in and buy our movie industry when we can only sell X number, 42 excellent films each year into China, which is now the world's largest box office market.
So let's turn then to some policy questions. Mm-hmm. A number of you mentioned the demise of the TPP that we had not signed. One fairly quick reaction, my understanding is Senator McCain has put forward a military bill, which has said, I don't know if you've seen this or not, there's something on the order of $8 billion, I may be getting my numbers wrong, that we should basically bolster our military stance in Asia. To what extent is this a substitute for maintaining U.S. influence and for sort of meeting the needs of the region?
Well, I don't think it's a substitute. I think it's part of maintaining our influence. I haven't seen it. I've been in the UK a week over and just came in yesterday, so I probably missed a bunch of stuff. The devil's in the details. You know, $8 billion for what? What exactly do you want to do? I mean, part of it is that it's a moving target. You know, this is not, these things that we've all been talking about aren't happening in a vacuum, or better, in an environment of stasis, right? The overall situation isn't changing. I mean, if you want to now say that we have been losing influence in the South China Sea, or losing the ability to influence what is happening in the South China Sea, you can't just pretend that now these things have not happened, such as the island building, the militarization, things that we haven't mentioned. And actually, let me sort of divert from what you're talking about and try to answer it in just a slightly different way, or bring something else in we haven't really mentioned, which is the question of our allies and how important that is. One criticism I think you can make of most U.S. Administrations is that they have over-focused on China and under-focused on Asia as a whole. I just think that, you know, and it is a policy question. Do you start with China? Do you start with your allies? But we've come, I think, a lot in a lot of cases to think of Asia policy really as China policy. And first of all, Asia's a lot bigger. And that's something that I think we need to embrace, because there are a lot of willing partners out there. But we're in a somewhat interesting time right now where our allies are, I would argue, most of them not as reliable potentially as they have been. In fact, I think by the end of this year, the Trump administration may wake up and find out that its only really firm, reliable ally is Japan. We've all been watching what's been happening with the Philippines, and Trump may be able to bring them back on side, but clearly Xi Jinping has put in a lot of effort and really drawn Duterte into this relationship and given him things he wants, things that we don't do. And actually, Deborah mentioned some of it. We don't do infrastructure building. We do capacity building. Right, so you want better judges and police, we're your people. You want a road and a school and a power plant, you go to China or Japan. And Duterte has been saying, I want to build things, and instead we're hectoring him, so he's moved towards China. The Thai junta, it limits and restricts the things that we can do with them because of the coup. Australia has told us they're not with us anymore in the South China Sea, and that's been repeated not only by former Prime Minister Keating, but even current Prime Minister just the other day stated that if Trump continues down this road, Australia is going to be stepping back a little bit. And then there's South Korea, something we all really very carefully have to look at in the coming months. A constitutional crisis. The president has been impeached. She will most likely be removed from office. And we're going to get a left-wing government. How left-wing, how progressive, we don't know. But that often moves South Korea towards China and North Korea. So the question that you're saying about militaries, $8 billion is not going to do much to change that. You know, that is where you have to be doing old-fashioned politics. You have to be there and be present. And the Obama administration kept talking about how present it was, and that was a very good thing. But the trends, all of which were developing during these periods, have moved us to a point where I think we should actually be very worried about our influence and about our presence. And you need to rebuild the military, but that's only part of that answer.
So I like your reframing. So for both of you, I'll pose the question. What prospects for alliances in the region? What's left of the rebalance or the pivot?
So this focus on, you know, coming back to put this $8 billion, I think, you know, it's more about the optics that it's going to be on the military. So I was in the region most of the last month in Seoul and Tokyo and Thailand as well. And, you know, especially in Tokyo, they were talking a lot about we need to find a way to link the Northeast Asia with Southeast Asia in terms of economics. That's going to be very important because with the loss, at that point, they were already expecting the loss of TPP. And so now if you remove the economic component of the Asia pivot, all that you're left is the military component. There's a bit of a diplomatic component as well, of course, but that military component, the optics are that China now feels increasingly encircled. And, you know, as it's being encircled, you know, we can expect that it may act a little more aggressively. You know, when you talk about that in terms of our alliances, the Japanese, I think, are somewhat hopeful for a Trump administration that they're going to start taking a harder line on China. This is something that you know, I heard throughout the meetings there, is that finally there may be a recognition that China is going to be an adversary and we need to start planning for this seriously. That was from people on the military side. So there was a lot of hope on that. for the South Koreans, you know, Misha alluded to this kind of constitutional crisis that's going on there. It's not quite clear. You know, one of the things that matters a lot is presidential relationships, specifically in the Korea-U.S. relationship. And with a left-wing, will probably be an opposition government coming in, paired with Donald Trump, it's not going to be a good relationship. And it's going to create gaps specifically, you know, between the position of South Korea and the U.S. on North Korea. The gap is going to be widened between South Korea and Japan. And so while the Obama administration has done a lot of work to consolidate that trilateral relationship, I think we're going to see that start to split apart. And I would expect China to try to take advantage, and North Korea certainly to start to look at more ways for low-intensity provocations to try to further that gap.
I agree with both of the previous comments, because, you know, military power and might is only effective when it's part of an overall strategy. And so it's for the U.S., unlike China, we can't really go in and buy influence in the same way. And so it's important to be looking at building up those strategic alliances, but I think what we've gotten away from is an overall strategy for what we want in Asia. And we need to reassess what American interests are in the region as well as with the individual countries. And that is, I think there has been more of a reaction in our policy in the last few years than there has been thinking clearly of ultimately where are we looking to have a relationship with China and where does it go? How do we see development of opportunities with Japan and what's their continuing role, both in our bilateral relationship, but as a player in the region? And how can we consolidate these efforts to look at moving ahead? I work for Hank Paulson, who, you know, runs the Paulson Institute here, and worked with him when he was at Treasury. And we created the Strategic Economic Dialogue to look at these kinds of long-term issues, because we knew that there were many areas that we were going to have a conflict with China if we didn't start to plan now and how to address them. And we need to go back and look at some of the basic, not just objectives, but strategies in the region, because as China continues to grow, its power is not just looking at through the intimidation of some of these other countries, but building up these strong alliances in the Middle East. And I would take Egypt as an example. You know, the Trump administration and President Trump himself has now a very good relationship with President Sisi. I think that we'll start to see increasing ties with Egypt and then being viewed as a strategic partner in the region, but so does Xi Jinping. And they've elevated the relationship between Egypt and China. Actually, Egypt was the first non-communist bloc country to recognize China, the communist China, many years ago, and that is increasing. That's an area of potential cooperation or potential conflict. So I think going back and reassessing what our own strategic interests are and how we look at Asia and the role we want it to play both in our overall relationship but in the global relationship with other countries is incredibly important.
Great. I want to start inviting questions from all of you from the audience. I'll ask you to identify yourselves, and if it's a statement, please put it at least in the form of a question. And wait for the microphone to come to you as well. Let's start right here up in the front. The microphone will be on its way.
I follow this quite frequently and on a daily basis, and one thing that you have not mentioned, what Xi Jinping did in Peru with the RCEP, the Regional Cooperative Economic Partnership, and that is a huge effort from South America all through lateral Asia, and they purposely left America out, just like we did with the TTP. So since TTP is kind of waning, Australia is trying to recover, and they're also working with New Zealand on this too. That was their statement with New Zealand. But what do you see with the initiative a couple of weeks ago with the regional cooperative?
Absolutely. I mean, President Xi gave a big speech in Davos that basically he was taking on the global mantle for free trade. And that he intentionally went to Davos because there's a recognition that China's losing the support of the business community, not just the U.S., but the global business community, who have traditionally been the strong proponents of better ties between U.S., EU, and so on. As TPP fails, they're stepping in. And as I didn't call it by name, but was mentioning now, the region is looking at their own agreements, and I expect to see China very actively negotiating regional agreements, but also bilateral free trade agreements with a number of these countries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would just, by the way, if you're upset that you haven't been invited to Davos, don't feel bad. It was Xi Jinping's first time too.
Yeah.
So, you know, he thought he might have been there before.
But they changed the date for him.
They did. They changed everything for him.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. If you haven't read the speech, take the time to read it. It's fascinating. It's this combination of folksy Chinese proverbs with a little bit of Lincoln and a little bit of Dickens thrown in, and a whole lot of Davoisie. I mean, he just sounds like, you know, perfect as this upholder of globalization. I think he's gone out on a limb, including with what Deborah just mentioned in terms of, you know, negotiating more agreements. He's now making commitments about roles that China has not played and will be, I think, very difficult for it to live up to. China's system, China itself, I don't think can replace the U.S., obviously. I don't think anyone here probably does, can replace it as the defender of globalization. But that's what he is sort of making a global legacy on. When you look at a lot of Chinese trade deals, I think people are going to start, they're going to be very disappointed. A lot of them don't materialize. A lot of them change as they go along. There are countries who do care. So if we're talking about what's going to replace TPP, there are countries like Japan, like Australia, Canada, and others who care about the types of what we call the gold standard trade agreements that we make that have environmental protections, labor protections, consumer protections. China doesn't negotiate treaties like that. So I think that actually there is a real possibility that, yeah, we'll all get a little bit, you know, into this China stepping into the gap, but we're going to find out that it really can't. And it may be more of a problem for Xi Jinping than he anticipates with just the rhetoric that is clearly stepping into a rhetorical gap on our side right now.
We have a question here in the third row. Coming from your right.
Thank you. My name is Ed Bacharach. And my, first of all, thank you all for these fascinating and timely insights. My question has to do with Southeast Asia. You've talked a lot about China, South Korea, and Japan. And will the security and economic challenges stay in East Asia, or will Southeast Asia become a theater for some kind of great game? What will the role of Southeast Asia look like 20 years from now?
Do you want to tackle it first?
Having just been in Thailand and Laos and Singapore as well, you know, I think they're somewhat favorable towards what's happening right now. The fact that they don't like being hectored about human rights anymore. You know, that's something that's been happening for quite some time. You know, the U.S. can no longer give aid to Thailand because of the military coup until there's a new democratic election, either this year or next year. And what they said while I was there was that, you know, we welcome anyone who can help Thailand. And so they're ready to welcome China with open arms. And of course, the U.S. is watching this. The people at the embassy there, they are figuring out ways that they can try to increase their influence, but it's not going to be easy to do. You know, we look at what's happening in Laos. Chinese, if you go to Laos, everywhere around throughout that country, there are nonstop just construction sites in almost every city with Chinese signs outside. So there has been a huge amount of money pouring in there. So I don't think it's a question of if it's going to be, you know, the big game is going to be afoot in 20 years. I think the game is already afoot, and the U.S. is probably a little bit behind.
I think that's exactly right. I was going to say that, and certainly, you know, the greatest flashpoint other than the Korean Peninsula, which is always the permanent great flashpoint in Asia, is right now the South China Sea. I mean, it's already shifted to Southeast Asia. You know, 70% of global trade moves through the South China Sea, you know, from Europe through the Indian Ocean, through the Strait of Malacca and Lombok and Sunda, through the South China Sea, ending in the East China Sea. It's all one great hinge that works together. Why? Because the productive economies of Japan, Korea, South Korea, and China are in the East China Sea, right? So that's why the South China Sea is so vital. It's not that China today is stopping freedom of navigation, even if it wanted to. But we are moving to a situation where the assurance of an open system, freedom of navigation, freedom of aerial overflight, may no longer be assured. And so the question, it's hard because what we want to do is say, well, we have to stop it now, or we have to, or just ignore it because it really doesn't amount to much. But it is changing. What the South China Sea is today is not what it was 5 years ago. It's like those old maps we had in our textbooks, you know, that you have like four maps on a page, right? And all the colors would be shifting because it's pre-Napoleonic Europe and then Napoleonic Europe and then post-Waterloo, right? And it's compressing a lot of time into one page. Well, in the South China Sea, we've gone from map one to map two. There's a lot more red on the second map. Does that mean war? No, but you have to start calculating risk. You have to start calculating how much risk you are willing to accept. Superpowers, as we are, and especially those that have built a system, are very risk averse. We're the status quo power. China is not. And from a status quo power's perspective, sometimes it makes a lot of sense not to take on more risk. You think you will make things worse and be more destabilizing. But again, it doesn't happen in a stasis. China has taken advantage. And today, were we to get more involved in the South China Sea, which is really the great power flashpoint right now, potential flashpoint, much more risk than there was 5 years ago. Now, if we say, well, there's more risk today, so we don't want to get involved. Now, the Trump administration has said something different. But if we say we don't really want to get involved, what does it look like in 10 years? I would give them the credit, I guess, of saying that they feel that the trends have moved against us and that we can no longer sit passively by. What they're actually going to do, if you take Sean Spicer's words, prevent, or Rex Tillerson's words, deny, those are extremely strong words that you're moving away from even realpolitik to questions of machtpolitik at that point. But it's because we've gone from map one to map two. So I would just say these are very hard questions. And no one should pretend, I think, that things are just done in an offhand manner, even when they seem that way. Now it's up to them to figure out what is your actual policy going to be. $8 billion is a sort of congressional intervention. That's not a policy. What are you actually going to do?
Getting back to the question or the possibility of China stepping in, I agree with you that they're not going to be able to replace the United States, but if the United States is not even on the field or doesn't have a strategy, what's the potential of China just lowering the standard in a new world order of not having these gold standard trade deals, of not really fighting nuclear proliferation, of not having alliances but having client states? And specifically, what do you think it means for the Paris agreement? Will China, you know, step into the U.S. leadership role there?
It's all you.
Well, on the taking the trade issue first, of course, there's a real danger that they're going to lower the standards. There's no question about that. I mean, they never are negotiating the kinds of trade agreements that we do and pushing for the kinds of market access. And so what they're going to want is to have market access on their side while denying any market access into their country. And so that is a lot of what we're going to see. It's not going to be the same kind of reciprocity that we might expect to see. On Paris, clearly Xi Jinping has decided for political reasons that climate is an issue that they have to address. And as you were saying, Misha, earlier, it's been bad policies that have led to these pollution issues. And every mayor, governor, up to the top knows that they are not going to survive if they don't start to address these climate issues. And overwhelmingly, the number of protests in China are over environmental issues. And so this great development and economic growth that they have has come at a very high cost. So they have been very aggressive in what they're doing at home to address this. And I think it's very real. What kind of global player they will be remains to be seen. They can talk about issues. For example, if you look at last year around this time, they launched their first green bonds. Within 6 months, they were the largest issuer of green bonds in the world. Now, how real are they? What are the standards? How effective? Remains to be seen. China's going to supposedly create a nationwide carbon market this year. My guess is they will, but it will be primarily in name only. So we're a long way from what the gold standard is in a lot of these issues. You know, President Trump hasn't stepped out of Paris yet. There is talk of what the administration might be doing as they look at the economics of the issue, putting aside any words around climate change. There are very strong arguments to be made for issues like green finance, for environmental disclosure, and issues like that that have nothing to do with the science and everything to do with the economics. And as they start to look at what some of their own domestic goals are of job creation and innovative financing and things like that, you may see that there are potentially changes in some of the rhetoric and policies at home.
Can I say one thing on this? Because I like your question a lot, and it's interesting. I think eventually, at some point, we'll all step. I'm a historian, so I always think of these things sort of, you know, how would a historian see it in 50 years? You know, what we're going through right now, right today, I don't think can be fully disentangled from the long debate we've been having over the question of American decline or not, you know, that stretches back 15 years. And everybody's coming at it from a different angle, but you know, we were declining because we were overreaching, then we were declining because we're stepping back, now we're declining because we don't really know where we're going. But I think we'll see it as this much bigger question of, you know, it's just easy to say the breakdown of the post-war order. I'm becoming less and less comfortable with the idea that there really is any type of order. There's been an American strategy, you know, denying the rise of hegemons and ensuring freedom of navigation. It's not an order per se. But just very quickly to your point, I would say that in this first 4 days, the administration has been giving conflicting signals about Asia. On the one hand, out of TPP, looks like we're stepping back and leaving the field open to China. On the other hand, we're going to prevent and deny China from taking over more territory in the South China Sea. That looks like we're getting far more involved than we were. So which is it? Are we stepping back? Are we stepping way in? And to our Asian friends and allies, they're probably not only just as confused as everyone else is, but at the same time, they may be thinking that the U.S. is out of TPP, so the benefits of a closer relationship with the U.S. certainly are dissipating or appear to be dissipating on the economic side. And on the security side, are they actually moving towards a conflict, in which case they don't want to be involved? So overall, the question of how close are you going to get to the United States appears less attractive. How much are you going to work with the United States right now because of the lack of clarity appears less attractive, because on the one hand, we're stepping back, on the other hand, we're going in full force. This will have to be clarified at some point.
So actually, Mitch, I wanted to follow up for just a second, and others can jump in on this sort of historical perspective. Because there's one analogy. You talk about the uncertainty that has been sown among other places. Some people have sort of compared this to the Nixon era, where, and you could see a couple of different parallels. One was the sort of so-called man-man theory, that you might be crazy enough to do something, so therefore you gain some leverage because of that. Of course, the other part of this was he was so credible on things that he could go to China. Mm-hmm. Do you see any historical analogy there?
Well, we're 4 days in, so you know, let's give us all time to absorb it all. The other part of the Nixon side was the Nixon doctrine, right? Which is that allies have to do more. And that's what Trump has said in some ways. Japan and South Korea have to pay more in addition to NATO. I was just a week in the UK and Paris, and obviously they're you know, completely flummoxed by all of this, as well as Brexit occurring. But the other part of the Nixon doctrine is, you know, you bear the burdens that you can, and you should be bearing more of them. And that's something that he has also in ways stated. So the madman theory, right, not in the sense that it's been a sort of thought out, you know, Kissingerian approach to creating strategic uncertainty that we will benefit from, but rather that the question is a legitimate one in many people's mind. You know, they feel it may be a legitimate question. And then the Nixon can go to China thing, it's very interesting. The one way that may be happening is it didn't get a lot of press, was the Trump Duterte call. Which is very interesting. I mean, you know, the Obama Duterte policy really was a failure. It was very bad. It became very personal. As Carl was mentioning, the importance of personal relations. This was horrible. And we saw the Philippines shifting, and then all of a sudden Trump calls Duterte. Duterte gets off the phone, says, he's my brother, this is the greatest phone call I've ever had, I've been invited to the White House. You know, again, the proof is in the eating of the pudding, but, you know, again, maybe it's Trump as the negotiator understands things that Obama maybe sort of felt he was above the fray on, and he's going to get in there and sort of, in a Johnsonian way, LBJ way, get in your face and twist your elbow, because he can do that. And so he can make things happen that in other ways you thought, well, we might be just sort of stuck with diplomatic niceties. I don't know.
He does have to be careful about accepting any helicopter rides.
Yeah, sure.
A little Duterte humor there. Other questions. Let's go back here, please. It's right on your side.
I'm Doug Asbury. Recently, I read that one of the former diplomats from North Korea defected and has been talking about the weakness, the growing weakness of Kim Jong-un. And looking at the things that Trump has said prior to becoming president and then since about needing to increase our nuclear arsenal, building it so high that no one would ever threaten us, I'm wondering if the weakness of Kim Jong-un being made more evident to the world might make him do something to show his strength or to reassert his strength that would perhaps trigger a response from President Trump that could turn into a major conflict. And behind that also is the fact that a number of scholars believe that the historical circumstances in recent years have been such that in the past, when those historical circumstances existed, it always ended up in a major conflict. So I'm wondering what your perception is on those various situations.
I'll handle the North Korea part of that. You know, I would be careful basing everything off the statements of one defector. You know, if suddenly someone shows up who starts to tell us what we want to hear, and then we're all singing his praises. You know, I think that's a dangerous thing to do. But you know, the fact is that 5 years on, we have a Kim Jong-un in power still. They have a stronger economy. They have, you know, even though the black markets are there, there's much greater access to goods. There's much greater access to information. And I think what has been assumed is that the inflow of information would weaken the regime. The inflow of goods would weaken the regime. But I actually think it might have the opposite effect in the short to medium term. Because suddenly you have citizens who are being told that, you know, the only reason that they're poor is because of outside interference. You know, it's the U.S. that's causing all this. And suddenly he can position himself saying, well, I can't give you what you want because of this, but now you're getting it. And so it reinforces his position that you know, well, wait until the sanctions are lifted. You know, you think you're doing good now, wait until the sanctions are lifted. And so now the citizens, even though they have all this increased information, they start to view their leadership is as providing some of these things in a way. In the long term, I think it will be undermining, but in the short to medium term, I think it will increase support rather than undermine it. But you know, that's part of the problem is that we tend to be kind of expecting that, you know, there will be a collapse, that there will be this regime instability, and maybe they will do things like provocations. I think though that, you know, something that I was often told when I started in on thinking about North Korea and studying it, is that anyone who tells you that they know what's going on inside North Korea is either lying to themselves or lying to you. So, you know, there probably will be provocations, but they're going to do that on their own timeline. I never really think that it's in response to outside influences. You know, they may paint it that way, but the reality is they're going to test their nuclear weapons when they're ready. They're going to test their ICBMs when they're ready and when it makes sense for them. How the Trump administration will respond, you know, who knows? That's going to be an open question, and unfortunately, we may find out very soon with reports that ICBMs are being prepared for launch in North Korea.
Let me build off that question, and this is a question for all three of our panelists. If you have to predict, and you know, gaze into your crystal ball, for where is a challenge going to come from, like sort of emanating out of this region? So North Korea is clearly one possibility.
Yes.
Where do you see the most likely points where they're going to be presented with a challenge?
Well, I do think North Korea is the biggest danger that we face, and something happening in the very near term, because really until the administration really gets, you know, on its feet, and if you even look at the org chart of the State Department, I mean, the major positions still haven't been filled, We don't have somebody who is the Assistant Secretary for Asia designated. We have somebody who has background at the NSC but doesn't have real government experience on some of these policy issues. And you don't yet have the kinds of relations with the Chinese leadership that previous administrations have had. I don't think President Trump has ever been to China. Steve Mnuchin hasn't. Rex Tillerson certainly has and probably does have some of those relationships, but by and large, most of the administration doesn't have any experience with China.
And this would be important for coordinating.
And that's what I was just going to say. So therefore, if there is a reaction, we can't really take action without coordinating with China. I think there'd be a serious, serious problem. We need China's help in how we approach North Korea and what we do, and I think that is potentially one of the biggest challenges in the short term.
I think the challenge, you know, setting aside North Korea is going to be corralling our allies. You know, they're all looking at China in different ways, and especially if in Northeast Asia, getting the South Koreans and the Japanese on the same page. You know, they had this comfort women deal that was sealed in 2015, right at the end of the year. It's come back up. It's opened old wounds, and rather than coming closer together, they're now starting to drift apart. And as I think I said previously, that's going to be open opportunities for China and North Korea. So it's going to be a big challenge to try to get the South Koreans and the Japanese to come closer together and work together to do things like naval exercises, to go after or to start looking for submarines out of North Korea. You know, we tend to think that, well, North Korea's submarines are 50, 60 years old. They must be very easy to track. That's not the case. You know, once they go under, because they are old technology, they're almost impossible to trace. And so we have to do a much better job of getting our allies together so we can do exercises like that to try to mitigate risk where we can.
Yeah, I feel sort of bad. I mean, I've written a whole book on risks in Asia, and I can't really, you know, think of anything all that interesting or new. I was trying to think outside of the box here. Obviously I agree with both of those. I think though, given the what President Trump has said and folks around him, that the South China Sea might actually turn out to be something much more vital in terms of a miscalculation or an accident than we may have thought. Well, you know, first the Chinese have, you know, their statesmen, their rhetoric has started ratcheting up in terms of, you know, inalienable claims, and these are absolute. So they're clearly not saying there's any room for negotiating or discussing any of this. For a couple of years, we've all been expecting an air defense identification zone over the South China Sea. This might be the right time for them to do it, to say that, not only can you not stop us, deny us, and prevent us, but we're actually going to be expanding the sort of zone of control that we have. Another element in this is Pacific Command, which under the Obama administration had really felt constrained from doing things like freedom of navigation operations, doing them regularly, doing them very, very blatantly and clearly, working more with allies.
Ships through an area.
Yeah, going into the waters, what would be the territorially claimed waters of these islands, which, you know, the Hague ruled, these things don't qualify. They can't have this international legal standing as territory because of the type of geographic features that they are. So Pacific Command may have a whole bunch of things that it's sort of waiting and ready to do. The Chinese, as they showed us in December, were willing to grab a U.S. drone, U.S. property. They gave it back fairly quickly, but they may not next time. And they may show that they're willing to continue this. So then the question becomes, I think we've raised it, is, you know, if President Trump feels that he needs to make some sort of show of force or lose credibility because this has been repeated several times, what do the Chinese do? I don't think Xi Jinping wants to be known as the Chinese leader who lost Asia, so to speak, you know, who lost the sort of momentum of China being accepted as the dominant power or becoming dominant power. And so that flashpoint with a miscalculation, don't forget the EP3 incident in 2001. You know, a hot dog Chinese fighter pilot killed himself and knocked our spy plane out of the sky. This can happen again. Grabbing that drone the way that they did it, they could have sunk our small ship, our small boat that was picking it up. We could have had loss of life. It's all too easy to happen when things are going very, very quickly. Shadowings, things like that. So I agree with my colleagues for sure, but I think the big sort of great power thing might be the South China Sea now.
Okay, great. A question right here on the aisle, please.
You know, we talked about a lot of major powers in Asia, but we haven't talked about Taiwan, which I don't think it could be considered a major power, especially given kind of the shadow of, you know, the People's Republic of China, just kind of assuming that it's their territory. Do you think that Taiwan could sustain this kind of ambiguous existence as recognized, you know, only lukewarmly by most of the world, but clearly, you know, wanting to be independent, you know, going to the future, and given, you know, China's clear intent on aggressively expanding at least their military control over their immediate kind of border there, do you think Taiwan could ever become a conflict of West, particularly the United States versus China? You know, would we allow them to militarily end its quasi-independence? Would we, you know, would we go in and support them? Do you guys, you know, have any comments on that or anything like that?
Well, there's a lot of good questions, and you know, the Taiwan case is very difficult. First, I would say that we should be supporting Taiwan more. And there's lots of ways you can do it. They are a democracy. They are a Chinese democracy, so they sort of fly in the face of Beijing's insistence that, you know, the people can never rule themselves. So we should find ways of supporting them more. You know, our policy has been very clear since normalization with the mainland and the one China policy that we will not support or accept, a unilateral change by either party of the status quo. It must emerge somehow chrysalis-like, you know, that this will be accepted at some point. So if the Taiwanese themselves did that, I think we would have very clear standing to say we don't support this. Now, whether that's morally defensible or not is a different issue. But again, it has not been a stasis. You know, if you look at some of the very good reports that have been done, RAND, for example, the military balance across the strait has shifted decisively in China's favor over the past decade or so. And that's one reason that former President Ma Ying-jeou moved in ways that he did to try to tamp down tensions and enhance economic relations and the like with the mainland. But today it's very unlikely that Taiwan could defend itself in a way that it could have 15 years, 20 years ago. And so it becomes in some ways a moot point. Does it have to be Finlandized or absorbed? No. But it is also not the case that the Taiwanese themselves look at it, or responsibly in a strategic sense, should look at it as though they're just able to sort of pull that lever whenever they want. That is not the case. President Trump's statements that go beyond Taiwan, but to the whole nature of the relationship between the mainland and the U.S., though, may push that issue even beyond where the new government, the DPP, wants to go. That is another potential danger point.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's, I'm afraid, all we have time for. Please join me in thanking all three of our panelists. And let me just add that Misha will be available for signing and purchasing, for when you purchase the book over there. I recommend it. It's an excellent read.
Thank you.